We are here today to honor the legend. And remember those few young men. With hope in their hearts. And wings on their heels.
Chariots of Fire charts the progress of two British sprinters preparing for the 1924 Olympic Games, Harold Abrahams and Eric Liddell. A strong Christian, Eric refused to run in the 100 metres, his favourite event, as the heats were run on the Sunday. Instead, he ran in the 400 metres and won gold.
But looking at these annual sports programmes of the period, we could see that Liddell, 100 yards, Liddell, 220 yards, Liddell, 440 yards, Liddell, 220, Liddell, won everything. Amazing sportsman. Wasn't just running that he did either. He played rugby. But he didn't just play it, he played it really well.
There's a picture of him here.
He played for Scotland 8 times and won seven of those. Here he is, mentioned in a student magazine.
He had a rare combination, pace and a gift of rugby brains and hands. Makes openings, snaps opportunities, gives the dummy to perfection, does the work of three if necessary in defence and carries unselfishness almost to a fault.
And it, to me, that sort of kind of sums the man up. It goes with his religious feelings and being unselfish as part of the deal, I suppose.
In the film Chariots of Fire, Eric is pictured struggling with his decision not to run while crossing the English Channel on the way to Paris. Well, in reality, he had decided months before the games not to run, and there's no evidence that he agonized over it at all. Since neither the Sunday heats nor Eric's mind could be changed, he agreed to compete in the 200 meters and also to train for the 400, a distance at which he was not considered an Olympic contender. Under the watchful eye of his trainer, Tom McKercher, Eric worked out just as any other Olympic hopeful of his day.
For a Scotsman, he's rather stereotyped in Chariots of Fire. And, you know, he's made out as being some sort of rank amateur as compared with Abrahams, this, you know, well-honed professional. The truth wasn't really like that. Eric Liddell trained diligently. He went down 3 times a week to Powder Hall under the eye of a trainer, Tom McKercher. And there's no doubt that his style of training, although the quantity isn't the same as it has become, the style of training would be very similar to Harold Abrahams. I imagine Eric learned that the heats were to be on a Sunday in the autumn of 1923, and he would have made clear then that he was not going to compete in any of these events which were held on the Lord's Day. Eric's refusal to run on Sunday was probably quite unusual given the amount of publicity, the sort of furore that it caused in many quarters. Eric not only refused to run on the in the 100 meter heats, of course he also declined the possibility of running in the 4x100 and the 4x400 meter. And certainly if he had run in either of these or both these events, he would have won medals.
On one of those Sundays in July 1924,
In the stadium, 7.5 miles away, they were running the 4x100-meter relay. There was no sign of Eric Liddell, by the way. No. He was here, in the pulpit, preaching to the congregation. The GB team came in third, by the way. Now, in the Manchester Guardian, they wrote, the British team was greatly handicapped by Liddell's absence, being unwilling to compete on the Sabbath. So he'd rather be here preaching to a congregation than running his races at the stadium. Liddell had refused to forego his principles. Now he lined up for the 400 meters as a rank outsider in more ways than one. Liddell was placed in the outside lane, meaning he couldn't see any of the opposition. So he ran the 400 at the pace of a 100-meter sprint.
So where does the power come from to see the race to its end from within?
Abrams was in the stands watching Liddell run to victory, his head back looking towards God in his trademark style. He ran the 400 meters in 47.6 seconds, a world record. As some people today say, it's the best 400 meters ever run.
I mean, Eric never set himself up to be a leader particularly, but he became so because of his sporting prowess, because of his fame. And people admired him at that time because he stood for a principle, and they admired that. And I think today people are still fascinated by a man who could do that, who could so effortlessly turn his back on the things that the rest of us admire so much, and you know, the material success, the fame that we all, or maybe we don't all, but a lot of us do crave. We want to be known, we want to be admired, and he turned his back on all that. He turned his back on it. And also the principle of the Christian faith that he stood for. But it was the fact that his faith meant more to him than anything. And I think that people, even if they're not Christians, they admire that.
That's where the story of Abrams and Liddell finished in Chariots of Fire. But the lives of both men took on a dramatic twist that wouldn't be out of place on the movie screen. A twist that would take Liddell to war in China. A week after winning gold, Eric was back at Edinburgh University to collect his degree in pure science. He received a standing ovation, and the principal, Sir Alfred Ewing, quipped, "No one can pass you but the examiner."
Having graduated, it was just here through these gates that his fellow students just lifted him up. They put a garland around his head like some Greek god, and they carried him through the streets cheering. He was the most famous Scottish sportsman alive.
A year later, at the height of his fame, and with a nation's adulation, Eric walked away from athletics. He was taken by carriage through the streets of Edinburgh to Waverley Station, where the crowd sung for "He's a Jolly Good Fellow." Eric was following his higher purpose, to serve God, and follow his parents to work as a missionary in China. Eric returned to Tientsin, where he was born, to teach Chinese students. There he met and married Florence Mackenzie, the daughter of a Canadian missionary. They had three daughters, Patricia, Heather, and Maureen.
He had a winning personality. People just loved him. And his faith sort of shone out of him. He loved to run. He loved to run, and I think it expressed his joy of life. The film touches on the Olympics and the struggle and the difference between the two runners, the dynamics. But his real life began after the Olympics, and the important part. And as my mother said, he very seldom spoke about the Olympics. It was great fun, but there were other things that had to be done that were more important.
Well, my mother's best friend, who I called Auntie Betty, always said that she had never known two people so in love as my parents. And that's pretty important.
Toronto at the time, and Daddy was waiting at their place for her to come from work, from nursing. And Auntie Betty said to me it was absolutely wonderful to see, because he was standing on the porch, and as she came down the street, he just swung off that porch, and the electricity was fantastic between them. She came racing down the street, and he went racing to her and just swept her up in his arms. And knowing they still had a couple more years apart before they could get married. But she said it was just pure joy to see them together. 1940, that was the summer of 1940, and we were at Carcant, which is in the Harriet Hills. My aunt and uncle's place. There were several little cabins there, and we had a wonderful time. There were sheep on the high hills, and there was a river that ran through, and they used to dam it up, and then we could swim in it. And we had great fun and great picnics. But we used to have rabbit pie. I mean, things were rationed. Rabbit pie was lovely. But at Carcant, there were these wonderful rolling hills, and then the stone walls, you know. And he would all of a sudden see a rabbit, and he'd say to Heather and I, "Stop." So we'd stop like this. And he would chase the rabbit along, and he caught it, and he went whoop like this, and it was dead. Well, we were horrified. He didn't do that again in front of us. But then he said to us, "Now, if you want to catch a rabbit, you can catch it if you put salt on its tail." So Heather and I madly ran around with salt shakers saying we got this close. But yeah, no, he could catch a rabbit. Yeah.
He was a great family man. People spoke about his athletic prowess. He was a missionary. But they didn't often talk about him as a family man. So not much has been made of the family side of his life, I think.
It was getting so uncertain in China, and she had two small children, expecting a third, and I know Mother said to me she was afraid, he was afraid that maybe we would be kidnapped or taken hostage, and then he would have to do things that he didn't want to do, and he could do his work better if he knew that we were safe in Canada and we would wait. And when the bigness of the war at that time was over, he would join us, and then they would decide what to do. But 2 years at the most. And he was so healthy and vibrant. You know, Mother, they expected to be apart. You know, this was something you did. You gave up those certain things. The last time I saw my father was we were sailing back to Canada on the Nita Maru, which was a Japanese ship. And my father insisted that we travel on a Japanese ship, that we would be the safest, and he was right. And we sailed to San Francisco. And I remember it was a lovely, sunny day, and he took us down to We inspected the whole ship, and then we went down to the cabin. And my mother was about 6 months pregnant with Maureen, and she wasn't feeling particularly well. So he sat Heather and I down beside Mum, and he said to me, he said, Patricia, I want you to look after your mother, and I want you to look after Heather. and help with this new baby that's coming. And I want you to do this and promise me until I return. And so, of course, I said, of course I will. And we all expected 2 years he would be back. And those words really stayed with me.
Eric often talked about his family in Canada and what was continually weighing heavily upon him was, of course, that he had never seen his youngest daughter. In open conversation with others around and so on, he would speak about his family, but speak in quite happy tones, and what a wonderful family he had and so on, and how they were getting on fine. But in those times of those quiet times that we had together, one saw his concern and his anxiety showing through.
When we went to bed, we'd either read a story, we'd say our prayers, we'd talk about what the day had been, and anything that frightened us, we'd talk about Daddy and the war. We'd say, now, it's 6 o'clock here at night. It'll be 6 o'clock there in the morning. Now, the moon we see tonight, he will see tomorrow night, you know. And will he be saying his prayers for us now at night? We'll say our prayers for him. And so he was never far from us.
She said it never crossed her mind that he wouldn't come back because he was incredibly healthy when she saw him last. And full of energy, and she was sure that he would come back.
He had a degree in chemistry, and so somebody asked him if he would teach. There were three of us, the same age, the same class, and he taught all wanting to do science. And so he taught us chemistry.
But we had no textbooks at all, so he wrote his own textbook from memory. And he had written this little book, and in the front he wrote, "The Bones of Inorganic Chemistry. Can these dry bones live?" He had written. And then he wrote the laws and he wrote the experiments. So he would say, you know, I'm putting this mixture into this and I'm heating it over a Bunsen burner, what will happen? And then I had to know the answer. So we did all the chemistry experiments without any equipment at all.
You couldn't buy a Christmas card, obviously, so you had to make your own. And he was ingenious, and he provided me with a fun Christmas card showing some chemical reaction taking place. And it was from him, and it was fun, and it made chemistry fun. He was a really good teacher, but he had a heart, he cared.
It was about that time that I began to take note of Eric and realize that he was slower in his movements. In conversation, there was much less repartee. He was beginning to think hard before he replied. And he was complaining about December. He began to complain of very severe headaches.
And at the end, they had a hospital there. And he asked the band, I think it was a Salvation Army band, to play his favorite hymn. And they played outside the window, "Be Still My Soul," to the tune of Finlandia. This hymn has always been very special to us as a family. Somehow it just brings us closer to him. I wish I'd known him more. I knew him through my mother and as a small child. But one of my sons said the other day, "Gosh, Mom, I wish I'd known him. You know, I wish I had known him." And I said, "Don't we all?" Yeah.
The Salvation Army Band, where I played the trumpet in those days, the Salvation Army Band played outside twice a week, midweek and on a Sunday. Eric Liddell was in hospital and was obviously seriously ill.
And we came to the grounds outside the hospital and we were playing some of the usual hymns with patients inside. And the nurse sent out a message on a piece of paper, Eric Liddell is dying. He would like you to play Finlandia. Be still, my soul, the Lord is on thy side. Be still, my soul, the Lord is on thy side. Bear patiently the cross of grief or pain. Leave to thy God to order and provide. In every change he faithful will remain. Be still, my soul, thy best, thy heavenly friend. Through thorny ways leads to a joyful end. Be still, my soul, the hour is hastening on, when we shall be forever with the Lord. When disappointment, grief, and fear are gone, sorrow forgot, love's purest joys restored. Be still, my soul, when change and tears are past, all safe and blessed, we shall meet at last. And we played it, and it was a matter of a few days later that Eric Liddell died.
I felt just desolate. I just felt, you know, why? Why would God take him? And it just felt like the light had gone out of the whole camp.
Grown men who, under other circumstances, wouldn't be seen to be shedding a tear were, in fact, weeping openly.
I remember us as teenagers just talking, you know, why did God permit that, you know? Why would he go before he had a chance to get back to his family?
We missed him. We missed his example. We loved him. Everyone felt a loyalty to him.
The coffin wasn't a very strong one because of our limited resources, so we had to carry it very carefully.
Just about 3 or 4 weeks before he died, he had given me his pair of running shoes, you see, and I wore them, I remember. And we carried the coffin out. It was a very lonely situation. They read the Beatitudes, and we lowered the coffin into the ground. And it was a desperately cold day at the end of February, I think it was. And I was just chilled right through, I remember. But the thing that was going through my mind all the time was, is this all that happens to such a great man? Is this all?
Eric died on February 21st, 1945. But because of the war, it was the 1st of May before the news reached his family.
Well, I was 8 years old, and I came home from school, and my mother was crying, and Granny was crying, and I can't remember if Trish came home before me or after me, but I knew something terrible had happened, and they told me right away what it was.
Oh, and I think back for Mother, I think, gosh, it must have just been the end for a while, you know, because how old was she? I was 10. She'd just been in her early 30s. And never in the world did she think he wasn't coming back.
The Edinburgh Evening News came out the day we heard that he had died, and it was headlines in the paper. That really shook me. That really made me realize for the first time that he was quite a famous chap. And the memorial service, the Edinburgh one, was absolutely packed the church. There wasn't a place to be had.
At the end of the war, when the soldiers started coming home, and we lived in downtown Toronto, so we used to go and see the soldiers marching, their families would reunite there. And then when the parade broke up, this, you know, to me, beautiful young lady with a lovely hat and veil on threw herself into her husband's arms. And I remember very strongly thinking, gee, I hope Mom isn't looking at them because she's going to feel so bad. And it's not fair. It's just not fair.
But she was wonderful the way she handled it. You know, we took that summer away at the beach, and then she bought the house and we started again. I think the most important thing about my parents that I remember is their great sense of joy together. That's how I think of the two of them, with this great sense of joy in life and God and the world and people, and always expected the best of people and usually got it.
I remember Eric Liddell as a trim figure, wearing shorts, carrying buckets of water. Now, he didn't need two buckets of water, but he was carrying water for people who were old or who were sick or who were unable to carry themselves.
He was loving, accepting, and he would do anything if it really could help somebody.
He'd probably be standing in a queue for somebody else. He was, I know, for coal dust, which we had to make into coal balls for our fires in the winter. He would be mending the hockey sticks or refereeing a game for the young people.
It was his living out the Sermon on the Mount in his daily life that really has left a deep impression on me.
And my impression of him was that that was the last thing he ever thought about, was whether anybody thought Eric Liddell was marvellous. That he just loved God and loved serving him, loved people, and was delighted if he could do something useful. And if Eric Liddell was forgotten, that wouldn't worry him at all.
His speeches weren't the most important. The most important was his personal touch with people who were wounded. And many of them were the Chifu kids away from their parents.
I used to think, oh, Daddy, why aren't you here with us? Why don't you hear with us? It wasn't until years later, that I met some people, children, the children in the camp, and I realized what he had done for them.
We loved him.
He ran well. He ran well right up to his death. He ran well. Amazing. Yeah.
I believe God made me for a purpose. He also made me fast.